want to read a scripture to you, and of course Bishop Jackson has already rendered his eulogy by the life he lived. I just want to leave a scripture and just a few thoughts on this scripture. It's found in the book of Revelation, the second chapter, the 8th through the 10th verses. Those of you who are not family, if you'll be so kind to stand in reverence to the word of God. And there you will find these words left on record for our consideration for the next few fleeting moments. And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich, and I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. I'm going to place emphasis on that latter clause of the 10th verse. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. I want to talk to you for the next few fleeting moments from the subject, be thou faithful. Be thou faithful. You may sit in the presence of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, this epistle has a new pathos and significance. If we connected with the blessed minister named Polycarp, who is noted with almost certainty as the angel or chief minister of the church in Smyrna. He was the disciple of John. Uranus, who lived a generation later, told how in his early boyhood he had heard from the lips of Polycarp what John had told him about our Lord's life, conversation, and earthly ministry. Saints, how rewarding the comfort of this epistle must have been to this minister in the closing scene of his life, when at 86 years of age he was sentenced to death. Now, notice how every line had a message for him as well as for all who are called to follow in his footsteps, not only as ministers, but as Christian soldiers. The Savior reminded him that beyond the suffering of this life, that a crown awaited him, which would abundantly reward his fidelity. My brothers and sisters, this life can be a tedious journey for a saint. There is pressure everywhere. There are malignant influences and forces working against us on every angle. There are smiling faces, but conniving spirits. When you look at our present world, we note that it has been marred by saints, by Satan and sin. Sin has converted this world into a region of horror and a shadow of death. Day by day, we're faced with the results of sin, which in turn produces a life of suffering. And yet, as saints, we are admonished to endure hardness as a good soldier. As ministers of the gospel, we are expected to preach this gospel in season and out of season. We're expected to challenge the sinner to enlist in the army of the Lord. As ministers, we're expected to address not only the spiritual aspects of man, but the ills of our society. Therefore, we must note that our financial institutions are insecure, our educational system is subpar, and our medical system has very few answers for the maladies of our human body. Yes, these challenges cause us to suffer on a daily basis. Then we have challenges from our fellow man, from those who are within and without. Sometimes they seem downright unfair. We give it our all, we do what we can, and yet many times we feel like we're not up to the task. We live in a world where we're failing our young, mistreating our seniors, and have simply said to those who are somewhere in between, get it the best way you can. Yet we are admonished to be faithful. The ecosystem is bad. Our water is polluted. Our clouds are infested with unquestionable germs and sicknesses in all the land. We must note that sickness, my brothers and sisters, is the fruit of sin. Pain is the offspring of iniquity. This world in which we live is plagued with diseases, and yet we are admonished to be faithful. My brothers and sisters, when we step outside of the palatial walls of our sanctuary, we discover that there's an ungodly world, a world where we're lied on, mistreated, rebuked, and scorned, a world where we're talked about as sure as we're born, and yet we are admonished to be faithful. In this world, peers turn on you, friends forsake you, and we're often blindsided by those who we love and trust. But yet we are admonished to be faithful. And then it doesn't stop in the world, but that ugly spirit creeps up into the church. Our so-called brethren challenge our commitment because they don't understand why God is blessing us and not them. But yet we are admonished to be thou faithful. Well, my brothers and sisters, as I come to my close, Job said in the 14th chapter and the first verse of his book, that man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. Man, from the very nature of his birth, is frail and mortal, suffering and sin deals with him, for he is born of a woman. Here we must note allusions to the sentence pronounced on Eve. Like parent, like child, two of the evils resulting to humanity from the birth are mortality, a few days of trouble. Man, ever since he has fallen into this world, into this short-lived world, he has trouble on every hand. Job's testimony was that these days are full of trouble. I wish you'd help me preach for a few more minutes and look at somebody and say, these days are full of trouble. Jacob's testimony in the 47th chapter of Genesis and the 9th verse, at the age of 130 years old, was few and evil have the days of the years of my life been. But our text tells us, in spite of how evil, in spite of how few and noisome these days are, our text tells us, but be thou faithful. Well, the second evil is suffering. For Job said that these days are full of trouble. Man's life on earth is not merely sprinkled with trouble, but it is saturated with trouble. The first scene disclosed by scripture after the fall is that Adam and Eve are crying over a son slaughtered at the hand of his own brother. In man's history, even under an economy of mercy and the operation of grace, we find records where blood and tears are shed. These days are few and evil. This is the description of most men's lives. There is trouble both inward and outward. The anxiety and unrest of natural man's daily experience is challenging. And yet, my brothers and sisters, as we deal with the cares of this life, the scripture comes to us and says emphatically, be thou faithful. Faithful in the midst of what you're going through. Trouble finds the inroads into the domestic or social circles of man. My brothers and sisters, if you look, someone has eloquently noted that the world is an abode, which if it makes thee smile today, will make thee weep tomorrow. But yet we are admonished to be thou faithful. Well, my brothers and sisters, even Peter's crown of glory and Paul's crown of righteousness seem to fade in comparison with this crown of life. The thought of it enabled Polycarp to be appreciative of his ministry. Be thou faithful. How long should you be faithful? Unto death. I realize that in different versions of the Bible, the scripture says until death. However, the truth of the matter is that unto death means facing death and beyond. Unto means that when I look death in the face, when death is looming in our atmosphere, the challenge is to be faithful. That means that when sickness comes, we must be faithful. When disappointments come, we must be faithful. When life-threatening situations get in our space, we must be faithful. I'm closing here. But my brothers and sisters, we don't have to look back at Polycarp, the chief minister in Smyrna, to observe a servant who has been faithful unto death. Bishop Julian Jackson has braved the choppy waters of life, and yet he remained faithful. I'm sure there were times when the enemy said, you've done enough, but he kept on working. I would imagine he took to heart the words of the fourth chapter of 1 Peter and the 13th verse, but rejoice in as much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. Do me a favor and look at somebody and say, be thou faithful. I'm sure that Bishop didn't always feel his best, but he remained faithful to his task. And when he completed his task, he said, like the great apostle, I have fought a good fight and I finished my course. So his life preaches to us today by saying, don't give up and don't throw in the towel, for weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. And I heard the Bible said, be not weary in well-doing, for you shall reap if you faint not. Do me a favor and grab somebody by the hand and say, neighbor, be thou faithful. Tell your neighbor, hang in there. For I heard Paul said that I reckon that the sufferings of this present time, they are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And I hear the challenge. The challenge said, beloved, now are we the sons of God, but it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, and we shall see him as he is. So every day I'm crossing every T, dotting every I, making sure there's a punctuation mark at the end of every sentence. Tell somebody, be thou faithful. Tell them again, be thou faithful. And I heard the Bible say, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. Hang in there and let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain, and if when you give the best of your service, telling the world that the Savior has come, be not dismayed when men don't believe you. He'll understand and say, well done. Tell your neighbor, get ready, because there's no more weeping, no more crying in that land. I don't know about you, but I'm going to a place where the wicked shall cease from troubling, and the weary shall be at rest. Tell somebody else, be faithful. Don't throw in the towel, but hang in there. Payday is coming. After a while, God has not forgotten you. Thank God. And just as soon as my feet strike Zion, I'm going to praise him. I'm going to bless him. I'm going to lift him up, because he brought me from a mighty long way. My soul looks back and wonder how I got over. It was great. Praise him, praise him, praise him. You ought to give him some praise. Some praise right there. Tell your neighbor, I don't care what's going on in your life, be faithful to God. Oh, come on, you got the wrong neighbor. Tell another neighbor, I don't care what's going on in your life, be thou faithful. Come on, tell them again, be thou faithful. And God promised to give you a crown of life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I feel like praising him, but I'll stop. But this is a homegoing celebration. Hallelujah. I'm gonna stop, man. But Bishop Jackson, he got out of this world saved. And that's all any of us are trying to do, is get out of this world saved. Why don't you talk to somebody and tell them, I don't know about you, but all I want to do is get out of this world saved. Hallelujah. God bless. We're praying. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Everyone except the